From St. Paul's Baptist Church, here's the scoop.
The wait is over. On Sunday, September 12th at 10 a.m., St. Paul's Baptist Church will resume in-person worship services on our North Campus on Creighton Road only. We'll have announcements on the reopening of our other locations in the future by the grace of God. So visit mysbbc.info/reopening for more info. Connect with us for one-on-one prayer or counseling at any time during our Sunday morning worship experience. We'd love to talk with you. Join us in our virtual prayer room at mysbbc.info/prayer room. Every member has a mission. Take the next step towards yours today. Don't know where to start? Let us help you on your journey by taking a 10-minute assessment to learn and understand your gifts for your mission. Develop your gifts through our online bootcamp training and celebrate completed missions and find new ones. Lead, connect, and serve to build relationships within your team. This is how we win when you serve. Take the next step towards your mission today. Learn more at mysbbc.info/myfit.
Join us this fall at The Bridge for our new teaching series on Ephesians, a crash course in Christianity. In this series, we will walk through the book of Ephesians, written by the Apostle Paul as a circular letter for young churches in Asia Minor. Ephesians covers the basics of our faith, God's plans in Jesus Christ for humanity, the essence of the gospel, relationships inside the church, living for Christ in the world today, spiritual conflict, prayer, and so much more. Join us for a crash course starting September 2nd at 11 a.m. and 7 p.m. Spread the word, #Crash2021. A new message series starts September 19th called Plot Twist, Discovering the Goodness of God. It's a radical change in the expected outcome. It's a shift in direction. It can be a surprise at the end. It can change your perception of something that's already happened. It may be foreshadowed or hidden in the details. It may be new, ambiguous, misleading, or false information that's suddenly realized. What is it? A plot twist. Life and scripture are peppered with plots that don't turn out like we expect. Join our senior pastor, Dr. Lance Watson, as he leads us on a journey to discover the goodness of God in this new series of messages. No need for a spoiler alert. We won't tell you the end in advance.
Thank you for your time and attention. This has been The Scoop.
I will glorify His righteousness. I will glorify the Lamb. I will glorify His majesty. He is the great I Am. I will glorify His righteousness. I will glorify the Lamb. I will glorify His majesty.
He is the great, he is the great, he is the great, I am. He is the great, he is the What a glorious day to celebrate communion. The blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary. The blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountains. It flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. It soothes my doubts and calms my fears, and it dries all my tears. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. Today, we celebrate the blood still works. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving. Search our hearts as we worship today, as we remember the sacrifices of Jesus Christ. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your grace. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your extravagant love and unmerited favor. Thank you, Lord, that life abundant and life eternal. As you instructed your disciples, we too will receive bread and wine in remembrance of you today. You are the bread of heaven. Your body was broken for us. Your blood was shed for us. Thank you for giving us the victory in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah and amen. Happy Sunday to every single one of you. I am Minister Tracy Butler MacArthur, and I serve as Associate Minister with our Dream Chasers Life Stage here at St. Paul's. My prayer for you is that God would exceed your expectations, for God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all you can ask, think, or imagine, according to the power that works in us. We welcome you to St. Paul's everywhere. We are touching the world with love, communicating the positive power of Jesus Christ to our generation. Out of all the places and pages where you could have paused your cursor, you stopped here and we're glad to have you. There are a number of ways you can engage with us right now. If you're brand new, you can text the word new to 804-643-4769 and let us welcome you. If you are on social media, you can greet the person before you and behind you in the chat space with a great big good morning. If you're at home watching on television, computer, or iPad, greet the people in your room. Or if you are physically alone, call somebody and invite them to join online for worship. If you like something, hit the like button. If you think of somebody you want to bless, hit the share button. If the message or the music speaks to you, feel free to comment in the chat and use your life stage color. Whoop whoop. My main point is this. We want to worship with you, not for you. So let's connect, let's get involved, and celebrate the goodness of God together. Hallelujah.
Wonderful,
wonderful,
marvelous. This is the day the Lord has made. We should all rejoice and be glad in it. Happy holiday weekend. I hope that you will take this opportunity to not only worship, but get some rest as we prepare for the next season in our lives. And I am grateful to announce, as I always do, there's a word from the Lord. So grab your scriptures, whether in digital or hardback, and travel with me now to the textual territory of Ecclesiastes in the Old Testament, Ecclesiastes chapter 3. I'd like to read in your hearing the first four verses out of the Living Bible translation. It's a paraphrase, but it'll give us a fresh hearing of this familiar text. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, beginning at verse 1. Listen for a word from the Lord. There's a right time for everything, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to harvest, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to destroy, a time to rebuild, a time to cry, a time to laugh, a time to grieve. The word of God for the people of God. All praise be to God. And we want to tag that text with the title today, literally from verse 4, where it says, a time to grieve. We want to talk about, I'm sorry for your loss. I'm sorry for your loss, no matter what your losses have been. Your loss of friends and family, of choices and chances, of co-workers and neighbors, of love and laughter, of dreams and desires, of aspiration and affiliation, of health and hope, of moments and memories. I'm sorry for your loss, and all of us have some. Everybody who lives long enough to become conscious of life will experience not only gains, but losses, not only gladness, but suffering. Not only triumphs, but troubles. Not only wonders, but worries. Not only stability, but uncertainty. We cannot escape it and will not avoid it. I'm sorry for your loss, for we are all bound together by our shared common experience of loss. Think of what we have lost during this global pandemic. Think of the lives lost, millions worldwide and hundreds of thousands here in our country. Think of the empty spaces left in families and workplaces and communities. Think of the businesses that have lost revenue, employees that have lost jobs, workers that have lost wages, airlines, trains, buses, and ships that have lost passengers, schools that have lost students, and churches that have lost members. Think for a moment of the people that have lost homes, health, finances, food security, mental and emotional certainty. In recent history, we have lost milestones we couldn't celebrate, like graduations, birthdays, weddings, and even funerals. The coronavirus pandemic has disrupted and continues to disrupt our lives in some deeply profound ways. I'm sorry for your loss, and I share your grief. Yes, grief. Grief is normal. Grief is natural. Grief is reasonable. E.A. Buccaneri, in Brushstrokes of a Gadfly, said, grief is the price we pay for love. John Green, in The Fault in Our Stars, says, grief does not change you, it reveals you. When you've lost whatever or whoever you've lost, grief is the inevitable after effect. Face it, in this life, we will encounter many things that are incomprehensible and inexplicable. Life itself is transitory and temporary. Life constantly confronts us with changes and challenges. Just when we think things are calm, something happens chaotic. Just when we believe circumstances are stable, things get shaky. If today you are not shouldering through a season of loss, this word is prevented for you. If today you are currently struggling in a season of loss, I pray that this word is therapeutic for you. But if you haven't yet seen a season of loss, let this word be cautionary for you, because one day you will. Your time is coming, because grief and loss, get it down, are a part of life. Somebody ought to type IKTR in the comments section, because that's the assertion of our text for today. The wisdom writer wraps all of reality in the seasons and announces in verse 4 of Ecclesiastes 3, there is a time to grieve. Now train your attention on that text and let's examine why. What's the reason for life's losses? Why are there seasons of loss in our lives? Here it is. First of all, we live in a fallen world. The New Testament writer of Romans 8 said it this way, the entire creation groans. Ours is an imperfect world, not because God designed it that way, but because of the impact of our decisions as human beings. Our planet has a fever. Heat waves, wildfires, and drought are occurring with record-breaking regularity, driven in part by human activity. Last month was the hottest month on record since they began keeping records. We live in a fallen world, geologically and morally, during this pandemic. While the poor got poorer, the rich became incredibly richer. The challenges of systemic racism, systemic poverty, ecological devastation, the denial of healthcare and its access, the war economy, and the false moral narrative of religious nationalism continue unabated. Sometimes, friends, we suffer not because of anything we have done personally, but because we live with others who are making bad choices that inevitably affect us. You may be driving safely on the highway and someone else is driving while intoxicated, and because of their inebriated state, your vehicle ends up in a wreck. You didn't cause it, and yet you couldn't avoid it. The writers of Scripture posit that the fallenness of our world is a reflection of our rebellion against and rejection of the Creator of the universe. Our rebellion and our rejection set off a chain reaction of consequences, a cycle of sowing and reaping, where not only do you reap what you sow, but sometimes you reap what other people have sown. Why are there seasons of loss in our lives? Because we live in a fallen world, but also because we live in a free world. Follow me here. God has given every one of us the freedom to choose. All of us would like for our family and our friends, our neighbors, our co-workers, our community members to live strong, happy, productive, and prosperous lives, to grow in capacity and sagacity, to rise, to shine, to give God the glory, to live in love and walk in peace and exist in faith. However, some of us have lived long enough to realize that you cannot control anybody else's choices. Did you hear what I just said? God is omnipotent. God has all power. God is in control. God could end the pandemic, stop wanton violence, conclude senseless murders. God could block genocide and terrorism. God could end war across the globe. However, if God did intervene in those ways, the unintentional consequence would be the loss of our freedom to choose. Stay with me. If our freedom to choose was removed, we would effectively become organic robots rather than free moral agents. God's perfect will is not always done. Listen to me. God has a perfect will. Let everybody type, perfect will. That is what God designed and what God desires. But contravening and often interrupting God's perfect will, what God designed and what God desires, is human choice. And God gives the freedom to choose, even if that choice is against God. When we choose against God, we are no longer in God's perfect will, but now God begins to deal with us through God's permissive will. God permits things to happen. God permits us to choose. God permits things to go wrong. Jesus taught his disciples to pray in that model prayer, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." The will of God is perfectly done in heaven, but not always on earth. That's the reason we often suffer loss, setback, and injury, because we or those connected to us make choices that are not aligned with the perfect will of God. Can I lean on that lamppost for a moment? Everything that happens is not God's will. Stop saying that. God may permit it, but that's not the same thing as God purposing it or God promoting it. We can choose right or wrong, good or evil. God's perfect will is good. God's perfect will is right. God's perfect will is just. That's what God designed and what God desires. However, when we as humans choose injustice, wrong, hatred, jealousy, envy, bias, evil, the only reason we survive it is because of God's permissive will. Let me see if I can help you see this. In the opening narrative of the book of Genesis, Adam and Eve are in paradise. They are in idyllic conditions. It couldn't get any better. But in paradise, they chose to rebel against God. And as a result, they suffered loss and were evicted from Eden. But they were still permitted to live. Why? Because God has a permissive will as well as a perfect will. But here's the shout: God also has a providential will that operates in alignment with God's perfect will and God's permissive will. God will orchestrate and navigate the circumstances of providence in such a manner that although we have rejected God's perfect will and God had to engage God's permissive will, God's providential will works in our circumstances and situations in such a way that things will yet work out. No matter how bad they look, no matter how difficult they appear, no matter how stressful they are, no matter how chaotic they appear, they will yet work out for our good and for God's glory. Get the lesson that God's perfect will is what God desires. God's permissive will is what God allows. And God's providential will or providential will is what God employs so that despite our going left, God makes it right. Despite our bad choices, we still end up in a good place. We don't know when to shout. We may suffer loss. We may endure hardship. We may have difficulty. But when it's all said and done, hallelujah, thank you, Lord, God will have the last word and it will be good. Are you listening to me? When good things happen to you in life, that's called grace. When bad things happen to you in life, that's called life. You can live holy, give generously, serve wholeheartedly, and pray fervently. But I'm sorry to be the one to tell you that will not vaccinate you against loss, nor protect you from pain. And somebody listening to me now is perchance struggling with discouragement because of the circumstances and situations that have gone down in your life. You're discouraged because of financial loss, job loss, the loss of family or friends, and you are wondering, why did this happen to me? We cannot say for certain. All we can affirm is that we live in a fallen world and a free world where anything can happen to anybody at any time. God's perfect will is not always done. We cannot blame all the bad things that happen on God, and nor can we take credit for all the blessings and benedictions that unfold in our life experience. It reminds me of a story I heard about a little boy who was playing outside one day, and his dad had been teaching him about God and how God created the cosmos. He said, "Johnny, who made the flowers?" Johnny said, "Johnny did." He said, "Now, son, you know that's not what I taught you. Son, I'm going to give you another chance. Who made the trees?" And the little boy said, "Johnny did." He said, "I told you that's not what I taught you. Who made the mountains and the rivers and the oceans?" And the little boy said, "Johnny did." And the next morning at the breakfast table, Johnny knocked over the milk and spilled it all over the table and the floor. And his dad said, "Now, son, who spilled the milk all over the place?" And his son said, "God did." But isn't that the way it is sometimes? When the good happens, we want to take the credit. But when the bad happens, we want to give God the blame. What things are listed as acts of God in your insurance policy? I'll tell you, things like tornadoes, hurricanes, earthquakes, and floods. We call those acts of God. But can I suggest that there's a deficit in that list, that the list is not complete? I want to give you a more extended list, because it's an act of God when the lost are found, when sickness is healed, when an addict recovers, when bills are paid, when biases are broken, when kindnesses are extended, when wounds are healed, when injustices are rectified, when you wake up in your right mind. It is an act of God. These are the reasons for life's losses, but let us look for a moment quickly at some responses to life's losses. I do not pretend today to have all the answers. My responsibility in this moment is not to explain all the unfathomed mysteries of life, because there are some things, honestly, that we will never know, that we will never comprehend until we see God face to face. That's what the Apostle Paul articulated in his missive to the Christians in Corinth. He said, "We see through a glass darkly, but then in that day, we will see clearly." My grandmother used to say it like this: "We'll understand it better by and by." We know that losses are going to happen in this life. Life is not all addition. It includes some subtraction as well. How can we respond to the losses of life? Wake up and write this down. First of all, you want to deal with your grief. Could I get 46 people to type that in your chat space? Deal with your grief. Grief is unavoidably real. Did you hear what I said? Grief is a process. It's not an event. It's a process that entails denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and finally, acceptance. It's a process. Dr. Thelma Bryan Davis, a psychologist and author of the book Thriving in the Wake of Trauma, warns us about the danger of what she calls toxic positivity. She pointed out that toxic positivity is the impulse to avoid all negativity by immediately seeking to shift attention to some positive aspect of the experience, no matter how shallow it may be. It is a way, she said, of silencing our pain by removing energy from it. And the bad news is, it does not work. Taking time to grieve, whether it's a loved one or a livelihood, is absolutely crucial to your health and your well-being. Grief is a response to trauma, and if left untended, it accumulates over time. It is grief that empowers us to remember without regret or remorse. It is grief that frees you eventually to move forward and relieves you of the need to recapture, recover, or attempt to restore what has been removed from your life. Come here for a moment. If you have experienced loss in your life, whether by death, divorce, desertion, or disease, or dismissal, deal with it. Don't push it down. Don't suppress it. Don't deny it's there. Erroneously, some believe that in order to be a strong person of faith, it means you always smile, you're always happy, you're always optimistic, you never grieve, you never get upset, you never cuss, you never feel discouraged, you never get disappointed. But let me be the one to tell you, since I'm on the mic today, it's okay not to be okay. Somebody ought to type that. It's okay not to be okay. I'm not making it up. The Lord Jesus Christ on earth taught it. Let me show you. He said in Matthew chapter 5, blessed are those that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Break it down, preacher. It's okay not to be okay. Translate it, preacher. It's all right to cry. It's all right to grieve. It's all right to hurt. It's all right to look up to God and say, God, I don't understand what I'm up against or what I'm going through or why I had to endure this. If you don't believe me and don't like the New Testament, regress and roll it back to the Old Testament. Look at the Psalms and discover how many times David literally spilled his guts to God and said, God, this is not right. This is not fair. You have to deal with your grief. That's the point I'm arguing. If you push it down, if you repress it, if you deny that it's there, it will show up years later, physically, emotionally, mentally, and even spiritually. Because when you don't tend your grief, you extend your grief. I like that. I just made it up. It was hot off the press. If you don't tend your grief, you extend your grief. Somebody's got to get that. The songwriter in tone, trust God at all times, O people, pour out your hearts to God, for God is our refuge. And here it is for you. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Sometimes things do happen that actually crush us, even as people of faith. We do get hurt. We do get wounded. The first step to healing from it is to deal with it, acknowledge it, admit it, and agree that it is there. Jesus said, only those who acknowledge their need of a physician are going to be healed. You can never be healed unless you first admit you are hurt. Deal with your grief. But also, number two, draw strength from others. In Galatians 6:2, the text tells us that we are to carry each other's burdens and in this way fulfill the law of Christ. Another translation says, by helping each other with your troubles, you obey the law of Christ. One author tragically noted that the church is the only army known that shoots its own wounded. We are not called as the people of God, as children of faith, as the body Christian. We are not called to shoot the wounded, condemn the guilty, or put people down or put people out. We are called to lift each other up, to encourage each other, to compliment and commend each other so that we can draw strength from each other. Hebrews 12:15 said, look after each other so that not one of you will fail to find God's best blessing. In other words, don't build a wall around yourself. Don't put up a shield around your feelings and your emotions. Let somebody know how you feel, what you're going through, where you hurt, what your questions, your issues, and your problems and your concerns are. Let others grieve with you, weep with you, console you, and cry with you. And that is why it is of utmost importance not only to gather with the entire family in the moments of worship, but also to identify and connect with a smaller part of the family in a group. In a group, you can know and be known. In a group, you can receive care and give care. In a group, when you're hurting, there's somebody to tell, somebody to call, somebody to share, somebody from whom you can draw strength. One of our chief functions in the Christian body is to encourage and prod each other to good works in the name of the Lord. So deal with your grief. That's a response. Draw strength from others. That's a response. But then thirdly, decide against bitterness. Let the whole church say bitterness. Job 21:25 says, some people have no happiness at all. They live and die with bitter hearts. Pay attention to me, please. Happiness is a choice. It's not a chance. It's not a circumstance. It's a choice. When you lose a marriage, when you lose a friend, when you lose a job, when you lose a loved one, you have a choice. You can choose to be bitter or you can choose to be better. You can rise and shine, or you can rise and whine. Y'all get that a little later. Happiness is a choice. I've seen people become bitter over the least little things that take place. They have never lost a loved one to cancer or COVID. They have never had a child to get sick or die. They have never been evicted, rejected, or betrayed, or fired. Everything has gone relatively smooth in their lives, but let somebody say the wrong thing to them. Let somebody look at them the wrong way. Let somebody fail to acknowledge them or put their name on a list or call their name in a public place, and they become bitter and acrimonious and cranky. But on the other hand, I've seen other people who endured loss after loss, fought battle after battle, experienced tragedy after tragedy, and still they have faith. They still pray. They still love. They still care. They still serve. They still give. They still press on in the joy of the Lord. They draw strength from God's word, God's spirit, and God's people. And what's the difference? It's their choice. They have decided against bitterness. Hebrews 12:15 tells us, watch out that no bitterness takes root among you, for it will spring up and cause deep trouble, hurting many in their spiritual lives. Notice, it hurts many in their spiritual lives. Your bitterness doesn't just hurt the one you're bitter towards, it also hurts you. It hurts many. Bitterness is grief gone bad. Did you hear what I just said? It's what happens when you hold on to disappointment and anger and hurt and resentment. When we experience a loss, we encounter a range of emotions. And that's perfectly natural because remember, grief is a process. However, if we don't work through those emotions and instead settle in those emotions, they begin to eat us alive from the inside out. You can get through whatever you are going through. Somebody type amen. You can recover. You can survive. You can make it. You can take it. You can live beyond it. By the grace of God, through the power of God, in the Spirit of God, it's your choice, bitter or better. How can we decide against bitterness? Well, you're asking the right questions, because first you've got to accept what cannot be changed. Do you remember the Serenity Prayer of St. Francis of Assisi? God, help me to accept the things I cannot change and to change the things I can and to have the wisdom to know the difference. You've got to accept what cannot be changed. And if you live long enough, you will discover that many of the things that happen in this life are beyond your control. And there's nothing you can do about them. You didn't cause them, and you could not prevent them. And therefore, you have to know how to accept them, believing that God is ultimately in control, that somehow, some way, at some point, God will work things out for God's glory and for our good. Job said, reach out to God and then face the world again, firm and courageous. How do you decide against bitterness? Accept what cannot be changed, but then focus on what's left and not on what you lost. I'm gonna bless somebody today, because look at what the scripture says. No matter what happens, this is over in Philippians, no matter what happens, always be thankful, for this is God's will for you who belong to Christ Jesus. I mean, you lost your job, but you still have your life. You still have the Lord. Start with those two things. I still have my life. I still have the Lord, no matter what you've lost. And then give yourself permission to consider the hundreds of things that you still have in your life, despite what or who you may have lost. There's always something that you haven't lost. And even if that's something, it's just your own life and your own relationship with Jesus Christ. That's something the world didn't give you, and the world can't take it away. There are some things in our lives that nothing can take away, because God always has enough love to lift us, enough grace to keep us, enough mercy to motivate us, enough patience to wait on us, enough goodness to embrace us, and enough joy to inspire us. Accept what cannot be changed. Focus on what you have left, not on what you lost, but also determine what is really important. Jesus said, our lives are not measured by the abundance of things that we own. Job said, we brought nothing into this world, and we will take nothing out of it. That's why you've never seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul trailer behind it, because you're not taking anything with you. And therefore, if you lose everything you have today, and you still have your life, and you still have the Lord, then you have not lost everything. You may lose your health, but don't lose your hope. You may lose your job, but don't lose your joy. You may lose your finance, but don't lose your faith. How should we respond to life's losses? You deal with your grief. You draw strength from others. But then thirdly, you've got to depend on Christ. Make Jesus the Lord, not only of your life, but of your losses. Make Jesus the Lord of your lows. Make Jesus the Lord of your labors. Make Jesus the Lord of your limits, as you make Jesus the Lord of your life, because the key to crisis control is Christ control. Depend on Jesus Christ. For what, preacher? I'm glad you asked. Depend on Jesus Christ for stability, because life will get rough. The going will get tough. The hills will be hard to climb. There will be mountains to scale, and valleys to navigate, and rivers to cross, and enemies to face, and obstacles to surmount. We cannot deny that, and yet in the face of that, we can triumphantly declare, God will bring us through. God will bring us out. God will bring us over. God will give us the victory. Won't he do it? Depend on Christ for stability. Psalm 125 said, they that trust in the Lord shall be as Mount Zion, unmoved by any circumstance. Isaiah 26:3, you will keep them in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you. Psalm 112, such a man will not be overthrown by evil circumstances. God's constant care of him will make a deep impression on all who see it. He does not fear bad news, nor live in dread of what may happen, for he has settled in his mind that God will take care of him. I feel my help here. Depend on Christ for stability, but secondly, depend on Christ for strength. That's why Paul said, I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength, because faith is not the absence of bad things. Faith is not avoiding the losses of life. Faith is not having cancer and saying, I don't have cancer. That's denial, not faith. Faith is believing that in spite of your losses, in spite of your challenges, in spite of your pain, in spite of your setbacks, faith is trusting in God and saying, I refuse to give up now. That's why Psalm 46 said, so we need not fear, even if the world blows up and the mountains crumble into the sea. God has not changed. God's power is still available to every single one of us, and God will make you strong. Is there a witness online? But thirdly, you depend on Christ, not only for stability and strength, but depend on Christ for salvation. Paul wrote to the Christians in Thessalonica, we grieve, but not as those who have no hope. Why did he write that? Because our hope is centered in Christ. He is the source of our salvation. Because of Christ, we can live beyond any loss, conquer any challenge, navigate any nightmare, develop any dream, manage any mess, solve any problem, weather any storm, handle any hater, answer any anxiety, bear any burden, face any frustration, grapple with any grief, rise above any ruin, and tame any trouble, because he is our salvation, not the government. He is our salvation, not the job. He is our salvation. Because of Jesus, we have hope, hope for resurrection, hope for his return, hope for reunion, and hope for rejoicing. You got to reach all the way back to the book of Revelation. Roll it up to chapter 7, where John said, after this, I looked, and behold, I saw a great multitude, which no man could number, of every tribe, nation, people, and tongue, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in their white robes, with palm branches in their hands, crying with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne. And then one of the elders answered and said, who are these in these white robes, and where did they come from? And I had to answer him, these are they who have come up through great tribulation, washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb, and he who sits on the throne will dwell among them, and they will hunger no more, they will thirst no more, and God will wipe, hallelujah, every tear from their eyes. My saintly grandmother, gone on to glory, used to pray all the time and close her prayers the same way. She'd say, God, when I've gone the last mile of the way, I shall rest at the close of the day. And I know there's joy that awaits me, because one of these days, when my bed becomes my cooling board and my sheet becomes my winding sheet, and I have to stick my sword in the sands of time and study war no more, over yonder, That's how she said it. Where the wicked will cease from troubling and the weary will be at rest. Every day will be Sunday and the Sabbath will have no end. Over yonder, we have hope for resurrection, reunion, and rejoicing. Because down here, things can get rough. Down here, there's pain and injustice. Down here, there's sickness and sorrow. Down here, there's meanness and misery. But we're on our way up there. That's our hope, that up there, the streets are paved with gold. Up there, we'll never grow old. Up there, there'll be no more crying, no more dying, no more losses, no more grief, no more struggle, no more pain, no more trouble, no more goodbye. I have a few more tears to shed. I've got a few more burdens to bear. But one glad morning, when this life is over, I'll fly away. And just as soon as my feet strike Zion, I'm gonna lay down my heavy burdens. I'm gonna shout, trouble's over. And so if you miss me from preaching down here and you can't find me nowhere, come on up a little higher. I'll be waiting up there. I'll be somewhere around his throne, because I want to be there when the saints go marching in and when they crown him King of Kings. I'll take off my cross, pick up my crown. That's my hope. Just as soon as I get home, that's what Jesus gives. Is there anybody listening who can shout thanks be to God? He is my resurrection. He is my return. He is my reunion. That's what gives me power. That's what gives me joy. That's what's keeping me, even in a pandemic, even in this moment, because one of these days, I'm going home. I'm going to put on my robe and tell the story how I made it over. I'll see my mother. I'll see my father. I'll see sisters and brothers, cousins and uncles, aunties and friends. But most of all, yes, I'll get to see Jesus. Is there a witness here? Post those hands. Is there a witness online? Shout hallelujah. Yes. I'm sorry for your loss. I share your grief, but I have this hope, and you can have it too. It's found in Jesus Christ. You may be in pain. You may feel hopeless. You may feel helpless, but let me encourage you. Don't look at what you lost. Look at what you have left. Accept what cannot be changed. Decide against bitterness. Determine that you will follow Jesus Christ. You still have life. You still have the Lord. You can live in that confidence. And this is your moment for you to put your trust in God through Jesus Christ. It's not hard. All you've got to do is text the word join to 804-643-4769, or better yet, take your phone and scan that QR code that appears in the lower third of this screen. It'll take you right to our prayer room, where there's a whole team of counselors on standby waiting to pray with you, to talk to you, to counsel you, to share with you how you can be saved and embrace the new life, the abundant life, the best life that God has for you. This is your moment. Now is your time. As we listen to the music, take that step. We're waiting for you.
I shall wear a
The goodness of the Lord is amazing. Has God been good to you? I know God has. So I want to invite you now to join me in the grace of giving. I love to remind people that just as love never empties the heart, giving never empties the hand. And it's easy to give at St. Paul's. All the ways to give are posted on the lower third of this screen. You can give digitally, you can give online, or you can give by sending your check in the mail. I thank you for your amazing generosity. Your faithfulness and your support are a lighthouse of hope. I'd like to pray with you and pray for you as you prepare now to worship God by giving your tithe and giving your offering. Let us pray together. Gracious God, your mercies are new every single day. We thank you for another opportunity to experience your grace, your kindness, your love, and your goodness. We testify that you are more than enough, ever enough, always enough. You are Jehovah Jireh. We give you praise for how you have blessed us and kept us in it all, through it all, and yes, despite it all. Bless these gifts and those who give them as we share together in this act of generosity. We refuse to treat banks and bills better than we treat you, because you are our number one priority. Thank you for the resources, but we know that you are our source. Thank you for who you are. In the powerful, priceless, and precious name of the Prince of Peace, in the name of Jesus, we pray. And all the people said together, amen. Let's give now as we rejoice in the music and prepare our elements for our service of communion, where we celebrate the Lord's Supper.
Wonder why the troubles of life seem to weigh you down. Well, I found a friend that I highly recommend, who was closer than a brother and will love you like no other.
Wait.
The Apostle Paul, writing to the Christians in Corinth in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning at verse 23, said these words, "For I have received of the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." He prayed, "Let us pray. Holy are you, O God, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and the recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save humanity. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with those who were outcasts. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery, and made with us a new covenant by water and by the Spirit. We thank you for this moment of communion. Bless these elements and all who share them. In the mighty, matchless, and magnificent name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen." In the name of Jesus, let us eat and drink together. And we do these things in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus, amen. I hope that you were blessed by this worship celebration today. I know that I was. Here's a quick checklist that we provide every single weekend. First of all, be sure before you scroll away to share this stream with your family, your friends, and your network. Our goal is 1,000 shares every weekend across all of our platforms, and your one will help us get there. Secondly, download the GPS guide, our message application guide. It's pinned in the comments, available on our mobile app and on our website, so that you can discuss this message about grief, about loss, about how important it is in our lives with your family and your friends. Let's share our benediction. It'll be posted on the screen. Would you read it along with me? I am because we are. We are because God is. You are not alone. Never, 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 never alone. God is with you, and so are we. We love you, and there ain't a thing you can do about it except pray fervently, love deeply, live authentically, and remember, you can make it on what you have left. As long as you have life, as long as you have the Lord, you still have a chance. Make this your moment. May God bless you, comfort you, and keep you. This is our prayer. Till next time.
From St. Paul's Baptist Church, here's the scoop.
The wait is over. On Sunday, September 12th at 10 a.m., St. Paul's Baptist Church will resume in-person worship services on our North Campus on Creighton Road only. We'll have announcements on the reopening of our other locations in the future by the grace of God. So visit mysbbc.info/reopening for more info. Connect with us for one-on-one prayer or counseling at any time during our Sunday morning worship experience. We'd love to talk with you. Join us in our virtual prayer room at mysbbc.info/prayer room. Every member has a mission. Take the next step towards yours today. Don't know where to start? Let us help you on your journey by taking a 10-minute assessment to learn and understand your gifts for your mission. Develop your gifts through our online bootcamp training and celebrate completed missions and find new ones. Lead, connect, and serve to build relationships within your team. This is how we win when you serve. Take the next step towards your mission today. Learn more at mysbbc.info/myfit.
Join us this fall at The Bridge for our new teaching series on Ephesians, a crash course in Christianity. In this series, we will walk through the book of Ephesians, written by the Apostle Paul as a circular letter for young churches in Asia Minor. Ephesians covers the basics of our faith, God's plans in Jesus Christ for humanity, the essence of the gospel, relationships inside the church, living for Christ in the world today, spiritual conflict, prayer, and so much more. Join us for a crash course starting September 2nd at 11 a.m. and 7 p.m. Spread the word, #Crash2021. A new message series starts September 19th called Plot Twist, Discovering the Goodness of God. It's a radical change in the expected outcome. It's a shift in direction. It can be a surprise at the end. It can change your perception of something that's already happened. It may be foreshadowed or hidden in the details. It may be new, ambiguous, misleading, or false information that's suddenly realized. What is it? A plot twist. Life and scripture are peppered with plots that don't turn out like we expect. Join our senior pastor, Dr. Lance Watson, as he leads us on a journey to discover the goodness of God in this new series of messages. No need for a spoiler alert. We won't tell you the end in advance.
Thank you for your time and attention. This has been The Scoop.
Thank you for watching this service from the St. Paul's Baptist Church in Richmond, Virginia. Please look through our website, myspbc.org, to learn more about our church, about our vision, and how you can support our mission to empower people to grow into the persons that God created them to be.